I'm saying, well, we got, you know, I didn't get it on my own, so don't worry about it.
Counselor Casey.
Thank you. I just want to pick up where Counselor Kennedy left off. I'm not trying to put you in the hot seat.
I was.
But with respect to the sentencing guidelines, we talked about those here, and, you know, we hear the argument that, you know, they're not worth the paper they're written on, they were never adopted, but, you know, on some level, there were some pretty smart people in a room. I'm gonna assume that there were some relatively intelligent people if they were assigned to this task back in the 90s. Who put some thought into this and developed these guidelines, and, you know, I think it's kind of foolhardy to say that you shouldn't look at them at all, that they should be completely ignored, because I'm not so sure that we have changed a lot since the 1990s. If anything else, I think we've become a more violent society. I think that lawyers have become more creative with their mitigating arguments as to why people should catch a break when they've committed a violent crime, but I think it's more or less that we've moved the chairs around on the Titanic than that society has necessarily changed all that much. I don't know if society's changed over the last 100 years, never mind since the 1990s. So if you could, I know that the answer to Counselor Kennedy's question there, I think what you said was you're not necessarily going to be bound by the guidelines, but, you know, it's your first criminal case. You've got to make a decision on sentencing. What is going to be your approach? What's Judge Callen's approach going to be to sentencing? Let's say it's a violent rape, okay, and it's a mandatory minimum issue and some aggravating factors. What's going to be your approach to, okay, I'm going to sit down and figure out how I'm going to sentence this person? Can you walk me through your thought process?
Well, first and foremost, I think that public safety has to be at the forefront of the judge's mind. Evaluating, considering what the sentence should be. Like I answered in response to Counselor Kennedy earlier, I'm prepared to hear and listen to the arguments of counsel, having conducted the trial, heard the trial, all that information that I can give them up.
What is your opinion about lobby conferences, and what has been your experience as an attorney with respect to lobby conferences?
My own personal opinion of lobby conferences is that they're not appropriate, that the court's business should be conducted in the court. It has an aroma of secrecy to it, I think, that in terms of the public's perception of the court system and what goes on in the court, there's a partisan in the court that sees judges or lawyers kind of trundling off the judge's chambers and gives the impression that something kind of secret is going on. And I don't think that's appropriate that the public has the right to see everything that goes on in the courtroom. My own personal experience is that lobby conferences at the beginning of my career were fairly prevalent for most issues. I remember being in jury charge conferences with the judge before charging a jury in the lobby going over the instructions. Tell you for a fact that hasn't happened in many, many years, that the charge conferences and other matters like that occur in open court. I think that's appropriate.
And what, I know Counsel Kennedy asked about your criminal experience, so I'm not going to rehash, explain what your experience has been over your career. What have you done, if anything, since the nomination, or once you put your name in play with regard to this process, to get up to speed, if you will, on criminal law and criminal procedure?
I've investigated treatises on them, the NCLE treatises on them. I know there's an excellent series of master practice that was originally offered by Judge Kent Smith from Western Mass. It's since been updated by, I think, Elspeth Sipper, who's taken over that role from Kent Smith. I've looked at that. I've investigated the availability of training with Flashner. Areas for judges in terms of DNA evidence type issues and murder trial type issues. I think it's important that if I am confirmed and serving as a Supreme Court judge, that I actively try to use my colleagues as a source or resource to help me get up to speed on various issues in criminal law. I understand from speaking to some judges now that there's excellent training for Superior Court judges, and that I can at least they report.
asked about this mandatory minimum sentencing. If you have a particular case where mandatory minimum applies, will you be able to impose a mandatory minimum, or will you subject yourself or open yourself up to creative arguments of counsel to perhaps do something different than impose the mandatory minimum if there's a conviction of a particular crime?
Well, of course, you know, there are certain mandatory minimums, such as life in prison, first degree murder, that are required, and there's no discretion in the judge that he sends him, although I think that would be appropriate in any event. But I would be, in the event that I'm faced with another situation that may offer itself to a creative argument or an alternative sentencing argument, I would be open to hearing that.
So, rape of a child?
I don't think that that's appropriate at all to consider.
So in other words, the crime, the conviction would have to be one that you would think appropriate to consider some type of creative argument. Not, there are some that you would say are not on the table.
I consider categories of crimes such as the one that you just mentioned, rape of a child, something that so particularly hangs up the guy you hold it to an alternative sentence in that regard. I spent a fair amount of my volunteer work over the last 20 years, particularly with children, for a very deliberate reason, in regard of our attention and support in all respects.
And I saw that in your materials. It's very admirable. I agree with you. I think that there are particular crimes that mandatory minimums are in place for a reason, and mandatory minimums have been put in place by our legislative process. And we don't elect judges, we appoint judges, and it's important that people recognize that separation of power, and it sounds like pretty responsible. So, how about the Second Amendment? I'm sure that you were informed by your very informed counselor, chairman, that I would ask about the Second Amendment.
Yes.
What's your philosophy about the Second Amendment, your experience? Do you have an LTC, Johan?
I'm aware of the Heller McDonald decisions. I've had, over the course of my career with municipalities, I've certainly handled many LTC issues with the chief of police. It's certainly a right that's guaranteed by the Second Amendment, an individual right guaranteed by the Second Amendment. Some experience representing gun distributors, lawsuits, personal injury. That any of these rights we're talking about, First Amendment rights, separation of church and state, the right to bear arms, individual right to bear arms, that the danger is not in guillotine right, but in incremental chipping away of the rights of the citizens. I've had a judge on the farm that I'd be particularly vigilant.
What do you think of the AG's recent decision with respect to copycat guns, where she has taken a different interpretation than what has been in place for about 18 years now from prior attorney generals, with respect to what that applies to?
I'm honestly not familiar with that. I followed that from a perspective.
Have you read about it?
Just a look at some of my close friends, folks that I used to volunteer with, were gun owners, one of the particular trainer in firearms, was speaking to me one day about it, very passionate about it. I had a friend who understood the issue without comment with any thoughts on it. He's very, very passionate about it, always spoke.
Yeah, signs of throughout the district. Well, the Second Amendment is a real important issue for my constituents, and I know it is for people out in Yonah area as well. You mentioned Western Mass, how beautiful it is. A lot of hunters out here, sportsmen and women, a lot of sportsmen clubs. I sometimes joke and say I think there are more sportsmen and women clubs than there are grocery stores west of 128. But it's a very important issue, and you know it's an important issue when, you know, we have Democratic senators in my district who have A-plus ratings from Gold. They understand that I appreciate your response on that. I just wanted to touch on a couple of your cases. And I did note that I was impressed to see that in the section on the JNC application where you were asked about some of your more important trials, significant legal transaction experiences. Question number 23 on page 5. It was refreshing to see, and I have to say that, you know, I've been here since 2011. It was unusual to see the number of cases that you cited that you settled, which I think is a sign of a reasonable person. And as you probably know, you've been practicing law longer than I have. A lot of these cases should settle, and it was refreshing to see. I think you had 3 of them in the section of 5 cases you were asked to cite that settled. Can you just speak to your philosophy about mediation, arbitration, and what you would do as a judge? And say you're at a pretrial conference and everybody submitted their memos. What will be your style with respect to trying to move the parties closer together, or just a very hands-off approach? Okay, when's discovery closing, and let's get a trial date. What do you think your position will be on that?
The most effective judges that I've seen get involved in that particular circumstance don't get involved too much in the merits of the issues at all. Oftentimes, the judge, of course, doesn't get involved in the issues of the case, but the actual issues of the case. The judge certainly reminds them that a case is better off, negotiated and settled, and the parties shape and some control over the outcome, rather than looking for 14 or 16 jurors in the box to listen to the case. And I can tell you from experience that that may be why. Trying a different case at 4 o'clock in the afternoon than you were started at 9. Things change. Things don't go as planned. Witnesses say things you aren't expecting. Evidence that comes in or doesn't come in. I remind the parties of that. That you're really much better off controlling your own destiny.
Very true, all of that. And just one let me ask you about the case of Richard Cormier versus Safety Insurance. I noticed that was a bench trial of 6 days, and it was a 93A, 176D claim, and you prevailed after trial. What were the injuries in that case? What was that case about?
The underlying case, I believe, was a death case. The underlying case was an individual who was hurt. Underlying case was tried. The tort case was tried to the jury, which resulted in probably $500,000 judgment against that case, which the insurance company paid. That was then retained by the insurance company to represent its interest in a bad faith lawsuit brought by a wrongful fair settlement. It was a great case. I tried to judge XT. Chris Doty was a lawyer on the other side, was a wonderful lawyer and gentleman, and we were able to organize that case. We thousands of pages of documents as exhibits
and if you'd lost that case, would he be here testifying to you today?
Question.
it's interesting, I look at a lot of the names in your application, Tim Burke. I see that you had a case with Tim Burke and settled. How did you find him to deal with?
Times. But he was had a couple cases with him. That was one that went right to the trial in Norfolk County. But Tim and I ended up getting along. We had another case down in Barnesville a few years later while we were on the contract. And after those cases resolved, he called me a few years later with a question. That was nice that we had our issues over the years and had an opportunity to reach out to me and ask
And how about Jim Meneses? So I see that you had a defamation case with him.
Jim's a great guy. I deal with him with some frequency. He was head representative of one of the parties in this defamation case. He also tried the Cormier, the underlying Cormier case. So the 166D case that I handled, the insurance company, Jim Meneses tried. He has a wide experience. He's very good.
And what's your overall philosophy on summary judgment? Let's say you're on the bench, and I do think judges have a philosophy. You can say it's merits, and whether the standard is met, whether you grant an SJ or you grant a partial SJ. But in speaking to some judges, some judges believe that people should just have that if it's a close call, if it's a jump ball, people should have the day in court. What's your feeling about that?
They're rare. I think that that's the law.
And are you a fan of mediation to resolve cases?
By the court or just in general?
In general.
It really is a great tool. This is a very, very skilled mediator job that can bring parties together. And the success rate of mediation is somewhere in the 90s. People go to a settlement conference. They've made the mental decision in their head that they want to get it settled. Parties, plaintiffs push on different parties that are owed money under a contract. Sometimes they just want to tell their story. They just want somebody to listen to them. So the mediator sits and listens to the person talk, gets their story. And that's half the desire of some of the parties to represent themselves.
How many staff persons, when I say staff, I mean, how many executive legal secretaries, paralegals do you have in the firm?
There's probably 10 admins and 3 or 4 paralegals for 25 lawyers. I share Mary Jane, works for me, and my associate Jesse Buffett is here today. Also, my bottom admin.
Based on your experience, you've been with the same firm, say a big firm, for a number of years. How are you going to treat the solo practitioner who comes in and not going to show up and say the dog ate my homework like Counsel Kennedy, but show up with
a
legitimate reason that you don't have all your experts' information, or you need a continuance on something, and maybe it's something that should have been done, but it's a solo practitioner. They have one secretary or paralegal, and they don't have the big firm resources. I mean, how are you going to deal with that situation? How are you going to be sympathetic to that person, if at all?
I mean, I think that would be sympathetic to that person. Solo practitioners have a lot of they don't have the administration to fall back on. I estimate that probably 25 to 33% of my business, my new business, are referrals from solo practitioners from the Western counties who have a particular case and a referral group. We work together on those cases to mediate them and solve and settle or try them. And most of our customers will be able to
taken, you know, one of the most important things that I think a colleague for judge should have, you know, among other qualities, but is modesty. And in reviewing your application at page 9, it's pretty modest to say I'm a poor golfer, but a named companion on the golf course. So that's a pretty modest statement. We don't always see that in applications. We see I love to golf, travel, run, but, you know, whatever you do, cook. What's your handicap?
Embarrassing to say on the record.
You're under oath.
25.
Maybe if you are confirmed, you can find a little more time to work on that.
Counselor, I don't think that's the message you want to be sending to the public.
Well, it's a different speed. But I've reviewed all your materials. I find you to be incredibly articulate, well spoken. You've got a really diverse background. One of the questions I did notice in one of your cases, it dealt with a foreign issue. Yes, and one of my question was, have you ever dealt with litigation involving the Hague Convention?
We thought we may have a Hague issue with that particular case, but we never quite got there. We didn't learn that the European law is quite different than our body in the States in that case. Quite a bit about how the Europeans use some of our own system.
Very interesting. So I'm just curious about that. But your home counselor speaks very highly of you. I've gotten a few calls about your nomination. I like your philosophies. You seem eminently qualified, so I look forward to taking a vote on your nomination next week. And I thank you for the time you've afforded me, and I apologize for not having an opportunity to call you. I, too, am running for re-election, and I'm a solo practitioner, and sometimes I can call nominees back. But if I had any concerns after I reviewed your materials, I certainly would call you. But very, very strong.
Thank you.
Ditto that from what my friend and colleague Jen Casey said. I don't really have a lot of questions, but I did want to ask you, what do you think is the most important quality that you're going to bring to the bench?
I've dealt with some difficult clients and lawyers for years. Be patient, take a deep breath,
you touched on something earlier, attorney, that I think is really important in your answer in Counsel Casey about mediation. And that is what I say a lot, that people really want to be heard. Even if they lose the case, if it's not mediation and it's before a judge, they want to make sure that they were heard and that they got some validation from it. Of course, we all want to win. But at the end of the day, they want to know that the system is working correctly. And that is not something that we can